You're listening to the audio production of Church Plantology, Audio Lectures by Peyton Jones, published by Zondervan and presented by the author. These audio lectures are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, Church Plantology includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources.
Welcome to Chapter 1 of Church Plantology. I'm Peyton Jones, and today I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about what is church plantology. I mean, after all, it's a made-up word, right? What does plantology mean? Well, it's a study of planting churches. And it consists of three overlapping principles, which first off is the scriptural model that Paul and the other apostles and even Jesus himself laid down for us as church planters. The second circle is best global missionary practices, the things that missionaries are doing today that work, that are still those same biblical principles that actually work on the ground today. And then the third one is, well, you know, if I saw those things in the scripture and missionaries are still seeing fruit from them today, then obviously every time that the Holy Spirit moved in power or there was a discipleship movement or any kind of movement where the kingdom of God really advanced, then I should expect that I would see these same principles popping up in church history. So where those three circles overlap, we call that a church plantology principle. And I think that's important because in the book Futuring, the author points out that there's a group of collective individuals, experts on world catastrophes or, you know, things like the pandemic that just hit while I was writing this book. And what he says is we're looking for the next thing. Well, church leaders are always looking to be the gurus that are going to tell you what the next thing coming is. But I feel often that the leaders are guilty of what Jesus said about the religious leaders in his day, that you can read the sky, no problem, but you can't read the times. You see, in the book Futuring, what the author points out is that previously, you have to go back to what happened before now or before the future in order to enact the practice of futuring, predicting what's coming next. You have to look at the patterns of what came before. And so for me, I'm always looking at what has God done, what has produced fruit, and what can we learn, and how does that affect how we go towards the future? Because I'll be honest with you, no leader out there has a crystal ball. Nobody's going to be able to tell you what's coming next. No matter how much money you spend on a conference, no matter what books you buy, no matter what courses you take, nobody can tell you what's coming next. But they can tell you how pioneers have charted new journeys in whatever time period they've lived in. For example, in the early church, that's what the book of Acts is. In the book of Acts, we have Luke, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, actually telling us this is how the West was won. This is how the kingdom of God expanded into a hostile pagan world. And their world, after all, wasn't much different than our world. I mean, so many of the things that I lay out in chapter one, I actually lay out a parallel because we are guilty of chronological snobbery. We actually look down on every generation before us like, what a bunch of morons, what a bunch of buffoons. They didn't understand anything. But what C.S. Lewis said was, you have to read things from the past because just like you see their blind spots, they didn't have your blind spots. You see, they see things in their generation that we today don't see because the blinders of our culture are over our eyes. And so we can learn from what God has said and done in times past. Now, I'm not archaic in my approach to faith. I would tend to be thought of as a pioneer, someone who innovates new ways. But I also want to hold one hand on the future and one hold on the past, believing that God has been in control and active over the whole thing. From the epicenter in the book of Acts, when the Holy Spirit busted loose and worked through individuals, I believe there are principles that Luke laid down for us then that we were meant to learn from. You see, this is the difference between methods and principles. Methods are formulas. It's something I give you today and I say, do these 5 easy dance steps, and you'll reach your community. Well, the problem with that is methods change, but principles do not. Principles are timeless. And that's what a church plantology principle really is. It's a principle that can be applied to anyone at any time, anywhere in the world. So hear me again. By anyone to anyone, at any time, anywhere. In other words, using those principles that are timeless, you are able to plant regardless of your context, regardless of what's coming next. And growing up like I did, child of the 80s, we benefited from Dr. Seuss, who told us how to eat green eggs and ham in a box with a fox on a train in the rain. That's what I want to know how to do. Wherever you drop me off, I planted in Europe and I planted in urban Long Beach. The two were nothing alike, but the principles stayed the same. And I think what's happened today is we have substituted principles with methods. Methodologies that quickly become outdated. Methodologies that you didn't earn. Methodologies that you didn't put in the hard work for. In other words, you didn't come and look at your culture. You didn't learn the heartbeat of your city. You didn't learn why something might work or not work. You stole somebody else's model. You stole someone else's methods. And at the end of the day, trying your hard, doing your best, bless your heart, your church plant still fails because you've borrowed methods rather than embodying principles. And when I use the word plantology, you'll notice that the cover of the book looks like a chemistry textbook. Because I do believe that the science is that principle. Those are the laws that God put in place. The way it actually works and understanding that is becoming like a scientist because an inventor invents new things. A scientist discovers what's already there. I believe that we need to discover what God has already embedded into the realm of ministry and mission. It's all there. We just need to uncover it. But the art of planting churches, that's why the book is called The Art and Science of Planting Churches. The science is the principle. The art is how you practically innovate your own methodology. You interpret those principles in your immediate context. And as you do that, that's where the art comes out. That's where the finesse comes out. That's where if you decide that you're going to plant in a gay coffee house using open mic, you do that. You do you. Because that's where you're at and that's your context. Or if you're in Florida, like R.C. Sproul years ago, who went out to reach a bunch of old people with a very traditional, very theologically heavy, very heavy hymn singing church service as a Presbyterian, that's what he did. And St. Andrew's Church in Florida was born. Many people don't think of R.C. Sproul as a church planter, but he was a church planter for sure. He embodied certain principles. His church plant looked nothing like the church that you may plant. But planters all across the board, this is what's encouraging. By embodying those principles, you get the freedom to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. Where the science comes in, I think He would teach you that stuff anyways. He teaches us those principles on the way. But the important thing is to get it right from day one. In the movie Dead Poets Society, Robin Williams infamously plays Dr. Keating, an English literature professor who seeks to light a fire in a generation of schoolboys at a famous prep school. Now, one of the things that he does is he has them rip out the opening pages to their poetry textbook. And the reason he does that is he believes that the whole premise of the book is wrong. In other words, the poems that they're going to read in the book are fine, but Dr. J. Evans Pritchard's philosophy of poetry is all backwards. So when you come to church planning, oftentimes you feel when you're reading a church planning book or you're taking a church planning course, like this is just big box launch stuff, which, hey, if you're going to launch a mega church, no worries there. That's fine. But that has been the bog standard of church planner training. They're trying to get most planners to start off to do this big launch thing, reach what they call critical mass, have now it's probably $300,000-$400,000 in the bank, and pretty much get good marketing and advertising and run a good show on Sunday mornings. The problem is that is so completely foreign to the New Testament. It's not what Jesus called us to do. He didn't call you to gather a crowd on a Sunday. In fact, if you look at Jesus's ministry, he didn't give a rip about crowds. In fact, when Jesus got his biggest crowds, he usually said kind of not very nice things to them, like, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. I mean, there they are, right? The triumphal entry. How many of the prophets have you not stoned and killed? And he starts to weep. And you can just imagine the disciples looking at him like, Lord, what are you doing? Like, this is our time. This is our moment. Like, we've been waiting for this. Everybody else has been waiting for this. You are obviously the Messiah here. Everybody, these crowds are recognizing. And everybody, to quote the U2 song where he sings about Judas and Jesus, he says, everybody was laughing, having a good time, except you. You were talking about the end of the world. Jesus there is like a mood killer. He then goes on to predict their destruction, like right at that moment. And that's a lot like when Jesus got the big crowd, right? The feeding of the 5,000. They were following him again as this miracle worker, a prophet. They would have probably stomached the idea he was the Son of God, or maybe even the incarnation of God. He was doing amazing things. How could they argue with any claim he made that day? He was causing bread to just miraculously reproduce. He was raising the dead. He was doing all these miracles. But on that day, Jesus looks at him, knowing very well what he's doing to the crowds. He sends them all packing by making this statement. Unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no part of me. That is radical. And there again, the disciples, they're stunned. And Jesus looks at them and asks a very pointed question. Are you going to leave too? You see, we don't often get the New Testament's message about crowds. If all of the church planter training, if all the church planting books are all about forming or gathering a crowd, then I think we're missing the point. Now, a crowd did gather at Pentecost. Peter, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, also said some not very nice things to the crowd, like, repent. You blind generation, who will rescue you from these blind leaders? I mean, Peter said some things that weren't particularly popular. In fact, he preached a gospel that consisted of this Jesus whom you crucified, pointing the finger. Peter took a crowd, preached the gospel to it, and told them to repent and be baptized. There was nothing seeker sensitive about that. Peter preached a straight, hardcore, upfront, in-your-face, no-holds-barred gospel. You see, church planting is doing exactly that. It's starting with the gospel itself. It's about the exaltation of Jesus. It's about seeing Christ embodied within a community. In order to do that, you take the Great Commission. You preach a gospel, you make disciples, you baptize, and you see that multiplied to the ends of the earth. And if you're doing your job well, then church planting is sowing, watering, and reaping. And the church is the effect of that, not the cause. In fact, one of the things that you'll discover on this course is I'm going to constantly remind you that as long as the church is front and center, locked in within your sights, you're missing the mark. It needs to be Christ, the gospel, and lostness in your sights. The Great Commission needs to be what everything else revolves around, like the planets revolving around the sun in the solar system. It's not the church itself. Whenever the church becomes the focus of your ministry, it becomes an idol. Now, that's not very popular talk, and I'm sorry, I don't think I'm going to attract any crowds with this, but one thing I will tell you is that you will be saved from a lifetime in ministry of misery where your church starting, simply taking a flashy logo, a sexy website, gathering a crowd, attaining critical mass, having money in the bank, and then finding later, years later, you're trapped into some big construct that you've built that wasn't even ministry at all. It was just good marketing. Hey, if the disciples wanted to be great marketers, they could have been. In fact, Jesus could have spent 3 years just teaching them how to gather crowds and making them awesome church starters. But that's not what he did.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.